morning.
Good morning.
How are you all doing this morning? Did you hear that southern coming out? How y'all doing? Good to have you all here this morning. Hanging in there. Hey, hanging in. I like that. Hanging in there. We did a little bit of elbow bumping this morning. That's good. That's good. Well, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice.
Amen.
And God is good.
All the time.
God is good.
Amen. Amen. Well, I wanted to remind you of the prayer circle is on Thursday at 10 a.m. right here. And it's a circle meeting, whatever you want to call it. But we have the chairs in a circle 6 feet apart. So please come and pray, even if you don't. Want to pray out loud, you can still be here and give your requests. Well, let's sing this morning, can we? We need to, I know I can't see your smiley faces with the, but I'm sure you're smiling this morning. Let's sing Sanctuary. The scripture on Sanctuary says, your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, therefore glorify God. Prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true. With thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy. Love divine, all love excelling. Susan Robinson is gone as of this morning about 4 o'clock. 4 o'clock?
Oh,
few others I see this morning are not here, not feeling too well this morning. Both Larrys are not here this morning. So pray for them. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, for being with us. We thank you for your blessings, for your watch care over us. Lord, I thank you for those that did make it out today, and I ask that you just be with us this morning. May you speak to each one of our hearts through the music, through the scripture, through the message of the hour, through everything, through the communion service. I pray that you just touch our hearts today. And those that aren't here today, Lord, I pray that you just touch them today. May you heal them, comfort them, be with them today. We know there's some that's either traveling today or is gone and from our midst and won't be back for a few weeks. And I pray that you just bless them today and bless the ones that are ill today that we need to remember. Think of both Larrys not feeling too good today. And I pray that you just be with them. I pray for Betty this morning with her heel, that plantar fasciitis. Hard to say, but it's painful. And I pray that you just be with her and touch her today. And God, I pray for all the others that we should remember. I ask that you'd be with the ones that are sick in the hospital and be with our country today, Lord. It just seems like it's forever that this isolation has been on us. And I know, God, that you have a plan for all this, that you have everything under control. And I ask that you just give us the comfort and the strength and the wisdom we need, Lord, to be going about our business each and every day and be with the president and the senate and all his cabinet and the governors and all their folks and the city and the county. Lord, I pray for all the ones that are in authority above us, that I pray that you just help them to know what decisions to make and be making wise decisions in everything they say and do. Help us to be able to follow the guidelines that have been set up for us to keep us safe, because Lord, we want to be safe. And I pray that you just keep us safe, healthy, and in the center of your will in everything that we say and do. And Lord, speak to our hearts today. Speak in that soft, still voice to each one of us, and start with me, Lord. I pray that you just speak through me and to me today in everything that's said and done. And I'll be careful to give you the praise and the glory. Amen. Of love. life today that is worthy of the Lord, and living the life that Jesus Christ has planned for you today. I can't tell you where or when. All I can tell you is where I've been. I've been to Calvary. I heard love cry, Father, forgive him. Now that is why I am living a life of love. I'm forgiven, unworthy of all the blessings from above. I am living a life of love. I am living a life of love. I'm forgiven, unworthy of all the blessings from above. I am living, I am living, oh, I am living a life of love. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." Well, the life of a believer. Kind of part two today. Part two today. I was reading a little article about Tony Evans. Heard of Tony Evans? One of the preachers out of Texas, I believe. And he wrote a book. He wrote a book entitled "Detours: The Unpredictable Path for Your Destiny." And I was going to read a lot in here that he wrote, but I'm just going to condense it down a little bit. He said, "Destiny is the customized life calling for which God has equipped and ordained us in order to bring him the greatest glory and the maximum expansion of his kingdom. Every believer must understand first and foremost that his or her primary destiny is to glorify God and make his name known. Destiny always starts there. It always involves bringing glory to God somehow. It begins with the place of God integrating into our own lives in such a way that people come into contact with him through our words." Amen? Through our words, spirit, emotions, and actions. If you want to find your destiny, find God. After all, he is the author of our lives, our journey, our destiny. Amen? I thought that was pretty good. That was pretty good. If you want to do that, read that book by him. I read part of it, but not all of it. Well, last week we got started a little bit into the 1 Peter 2 and the life of the believer. And last week we heard that Peter instructed us as believers to always abide in the Word. Amen?
Amen.
Must have our Bible and read our scriptures and engulf ourselves into the Word of God. We are to build our lives up through Jesus Christ, the cornerstone of our life. Amen? Peter knew that the church would encounter difficulties and trials along life's journey. So that's why he wrote 1st and 2nd Peter, was to help us in this journey. We must live the life as a believer in the world around us. And then we learned at the very beginning here, that we learned that live for the sake of the lost. And remember, we talked about who we are. Who are we? We're the chosen people, a royal priesthood. Amen? That should get us all excited, that we're a chosen people, because through God's help and through his grace, because we are all sinners saved by grace. Amen? We're foreigners. We're pilgrims. We're sojourners, because our citizenship, when we become a Christian, is heaven. Amen? Heaven. Earth is not my home. I'm just a passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. And then we mentioned about that we're soldiers. We're fighting a war here, a spiritual battle each and every day. Each and every day. Because we need to keep our lives the way we should, because Jesus Christ loves us and wants to protect us, and he wants us to be a witness to those around us, witnesses to the lost and dying world that's out there. And then we talked about everything we do is to the glory and honor of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Then we talked about live for the sake of the Lord. And remember, we talked about submitting ourselves to the Lord. We need to respect those in authority. We need to be a representative for Jesus Christ in all of our walk, in everything that we do during the day, and even during this pandemic. We need to live for Christ and walk the walk and talk the talk. Amen? As a believer, we're to live a life of love, like the song said, for the sake of a lost and dying world, and for live a life of love for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ in everything we do. So are you living the life of love for Jesus Christ today? There's a story, and I'm going to tell you this story, and you may have heard this little story. It's about a boy, youngest of 12 boys. But yet he seemed to be the favorite. So his father made him a nice wardrobe, or a nice robe to wear, and it was very colorful. But he was favored. And so one day, the father says, "Son, I want you to go out and see your brothers. They're out there in the field tending to the sheep. And I want you to take them a little picnic basket, and I want you to go out to see them." So he goes out there, and the brothers see him coming. And they look at him, and they're so jealous of him because he's favored. "Look what Dad gave him." And they said, "Why don't we just throw him into a pit and kill him?" Jealousy. Jealousy is a sin, right? So as he started to get a little closer, one of the brothers, the oldest brother, says, "Let's not kill him. Let's just throw him in the pit and let him die on his own. That way we're not accused of killing our brother." Right? So they throw him in the pit. And then they said, "Okay, now that he's in the pit, let's go ahead and have dinner." So they're sitting around having dinner, and they noticed a caravan of merchants coming their way. And they saw them, and they said, "Hey, why don't we make some money off of this? We could sell him as a slave to these guys coming. We'll make some money. And Dad won't know any different. And Dad will just think that a fierce animal killed him." So that's what they did. They got the boy out and sold him for 20 pieces of silver. Well, now by now you probably know who we're talking about, right? That's Joseph, son of Jacob, and all of his brothers, his 12 brothers. And yet Joseph did not get angry with them. He said, "You know, God's got a plan for my life. And what if it's supposed to be this and I'm supposed to go somewhere else, God's got a plan for me." And as Paul Harvey would say, that's kind of the rest of the story. We know the rest of the story is what happened there. He got elevated in the government, Joseph did, and his there was a famine, and the family had to come to get stuff, and all of a sudden they seek Joseph ahead of them, and they're going, oh no, he's going to kill us. Yet Joseph had compassion on them. Remember the whole story? It's terrible that sin happens around us, isn't it? Things that happen around us and we get angry at times, don't we, maybe? Shouldn't, but we do. That sin happens, jealousy happens. But Joseph, as Joseph did, he did not get angry. He did not rebel. He did not cause a riot because we couldn't go to our favorite restaurants and eat. Or we had to wear our masks all the time. He didn't get angry and protest. He said, whatever God's will is, I'm going to follow in the way that God has for me. So here we are today. We are going to live for the sake of ourselves. In Matthew, or in 1 Peter 2, starting in verse 18, it says, you who are slaves must submit to your masters with all respect. Do what they tell you, not only if they are kind and reasonable, but even if they are cruel. For God is pleased when, conscious of his will, you patiently endure unjust treatment. Of course, you get no credit for being patient if you are beaten for doing wrong. But if you suffer for doing good and endure it patiently, God is pleased with you. God is pleased with you. So the first thing that this scripture says is that it's our duty. It's hard to believe that when we accept Christ in our life that it's our duty to suffer, right? That's not what we're expecting to do. But because we live in a world of sin and violence around us, we're going to have to go through suffering at times. Now, this talks about the slaves. We don't really have slaves today, but think about this. This scripture can be applied to each and every person that's working for an employer, or even people that are employed on their own, self-employed. They are working for the customers. This can also apply to them. Do a good day's work. Don't gripe and complain. I hear people saying, I have this job and I just hate it. I hate my boss. He just doesn't do anything right. He's just horrible. As soon as I can, I'm going to get out of this job. Do a good day's job for what you're getting paid for. And have integrity and respect for that boss. Because God gives us the grace that we need each and every day to take it. Have you taken your employer to God in prayer this morning? Have you said, okay, Lord, this guy doesn't quite, he and I just don't get along, but let me pray for him and let him know that whatever we're doing, I'm going to respect his judgment and his authority. God will fight your battles for you. God will fight your battles for you. All you need to do is be a witness for Jesus Christ and follow what he wants to do. Emulate Christ in everything that you do. Emulate Christ. Is that an easy thing to do? No. No. People say, I hear that, and I, same way with me. When I was in the workplace and doing things, it just was tough to take some of the things, especially when I knew that maybe what the boss was doing wasn't exactly the way I would do it. And then guess what? One day I became the boss. And I had people telling me, hey, that's not the way I would do it. Well, that's true. So let's try to figure out the best solution to this. Then the scripture also says we need to work on our display or our example that we have for others. It says if we suffer for our commitment to the Lord, he's going to honor us. But if we suffer because of something that we've done, that doesn't take pleasure to the Lord, does it? You can't go out there and shoot somebody and say, Lord, I'm doing this for you. I'm going to rob a bank because I want to pay, I want to give some money to the church. So I'm going to go rob a bank today. That's wrong. And we need to suffer are consequences for doing wrong. On the other hand, we do need to suffer for, sometimes we suffer around us, and we need to endure that suffering because Jesus Christ died on the cross and suffered the beatings and the abuse that he took for each one of us. And look what he did. Did he get upset? Did he really get upset and yell and scream at these guys? You know, Jesus Christ could have called 10,000 angels to come down and save him. But he didn't. He died for each one of us, didn't he? And then was resurrected. Now we need to live for the sake of Jesus Christ as our example. In verse 21 it says, "For you have been called," you have been called, each one of us have been called for this purpose, "since Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example for you to follow in his steps, you who committed no sin, nor was any deceit found in his mouth. And while being reviled, he did not revile in return. While suffering, he uttered no threats, but kept entrusting himself to him who judges righteously. And he himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that we might die to sin and live to righteousness, for by his wounds you were healed." If you were continually straying like sheep, but now you have returned to the shepherd and the guardian of our souls. Charles Sheldon wrote a novel in the 1890s. In the 1890s, he wrote this entitled In His Steps. And in this, he talks about a fictitious town called Raymond, and it's a railroad town. The main character is Reverend Henry Maxwell. There will be a test on this. Henry Maxwell. He's the pastor of the First Church of Raymond. So on Friday, a man was out of work and hungry and sick, and he appears at the door of the church. So Maxwell listens to his plea and then brushes him out the door. On Sunday morning, the same man returns to church at the end of the service and addresses the church with his plea. He is out of work and sick. At the end of his address or his plea, he collapses on the church floor, and a few days later he dies. The next Sunday, after much time and prayer, Reverend Maxwell challenges his church with the following: "Do not anything without first asking, what would Jesus do?" And of course, like Paul Harvey says, you know the rest of the story. Some years down the road, there was a fad going around, the WWJD, what would Jesus do? Jesus suffered and died on the cross for you and I. He was the example for each one of us. Good Christians may be called to be sufferers. We may be suffering for Jesus Christ. Non-Christians don't understand this. And they're watching us every single day and they're saying, what in the world is going on with these people? This pandemic has been so stressful, and we can't do this and we can't do that, yet these Christians over here don't seem to get angry. They just find new ways of worshiping. And so what's with these guys? What's with them? You remember the story of Peter? Again, I've told you before, I like Peter. He kind of acts suddenly, and then and it's probably wrong. God has to forgive him. That's got to be. Remember when Jesus is in the garden praying, and the soldiers come in, and Peter sees these soldiers coming in, and he's wanting to defend Jesus, and he grabs his sword and slices off the ear of the guard. Jesus kind of looked at him in that kind of look, and he picks up the ear and he puts it on the soldier and heals it. Because that wasn't what God's plan was. He's teaching Peter, be patient. Don't jump like that. In Luke 9 it says, "Then he said to all of them, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and following me." Are you following Jesus Christ today? Following him as an example that he's given to us to do? Again, he could have called 10,000 angels to come down and rescue him, but that wasn't his plan. He was there to suffer and to die and to bleed for each one of us, starting with me. He could have got out of that. Remember, he prayed, "Lord, if it's your will, God, if it's your will, take this from me." And yet it was God's will for Jesus Christ to die on the cross. And then 3 days later, he rose again. Amen? Amen? Jesus Christ is talked about in numerous places in the Bible about being the suffering servant. The suffering servant. Not a martyr. He didn't die just to be a martyr. He's a suffering servant for each one of us. And then he refers to the sheep. Now, it says here, we are like sheep. We're straying. We are considered sheep. Anybody ever raised sheep or been around sheep? Have you? I have not, but I hear they're pretty dumb animals. And they'll follow, you know, they'll follow, am I right? Yeah. And I hear that whatever they think is the leader, they will follow them even if they have to go off the side of a cliff. They will just follow him because they're dumb. So we are like sheep. We're easily manipulated by what happens around us. Somebody is preaching falsehood to each one of us, and if we're not careful, we'll follow that person all the way to hell. But we need to follow Jesus Christ as the shepherd of us. Remember the story about it that Jesus talked about? There was the shepherd that had 100 sheep, and one of them went astray, and that shepherd left the whole flock and went searching for that one lost sheep. Remember that? I was that lost sheep that Jesus Christ rescued. You were that lost sheep that Jesus Christ went and rescued. And remember the story? Even the angels shouted and was glorified because of that. Jesus Christ rescued each one of us. He is the good shepherd and the guardian of our souls. I'm reminded through all this that I've studied about through this message, I'm reminded that I'm not my own. Jesus Christ paid the price for me. I need to look and read the Bible. The other day, Linda and I went and got our driver's license. Now, I remember years ago, 100 years ago, when I first got my first driver's license, and I was in high school, and my parents said, "You know, if you go take a driver's ed class, that we won't have to pay so much for insurance." So I took a driver's ed class, and I had to get a book and read it and study it, because I needed to know, when I got a driver's license, what did it mean? And I took that book with me to school. I read it because I wanted to get 100 on that test. And then the other day, we go to get our driver's license, and I thought, "Oh my Lord, we may have to take a test." And I haven't looked at the test, at the local regulations, but they didn't. Thank you. But that's the way our Christian life is. If you're going to be judged at the end of your journey on earth, don't you think you need to find out what you're going to be judged on? Every question that's asked you, everything that you've done, don't you think that you should know? So read the scripture. We were bought with a price. Every aspect of my life, personally, socially, professionally, every part of my life bears witness to my relationship with Jesus Christ. People are watching me. People are watching you. How do you act when you go into a store, a restaurant? I've heard many things talked about how we've done the same thing as a trio when we've gone out to eat. And we bow our heads and pray, and we've had people come up and say, oh, thank you for that example that you've given to us on prayer, because we get a little nervous sometimes going in public and praying, even if it is for our food. And so, thank you for doing that. Thank you. You are bearing witness to Jesus Christ today in everything you do. Are you living a life of love today for Jesus Christ? Don't fear, because you know what? As we have people out there watching us today, Jesus Christ is watching us. The Holy Spirit speaks to our heart and says, uh-uh, you shouldn't do that. You shouldn't say that. I'm trying to keep you on the straight and narrow. Remember the Karens along the trail to keep you on the trail, the right path? The Holy Spirit keeps us on the right path. Jesus Christ watches us while the world that is suffering and dying is watching us. Each one of us is being watched in everything that we say and do. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, for this day. We thank you, God, that you died on the cross for each one of us, that you suffered and died. And we need to take up our cross and follow you in everything that we say and do. May you check us. May you watch over us. May you take care of us in all that we're doing. May you help us to live that life, the life of love. And may we be an example to those we come in contact with every single day. Those that are lost and dying, for they need you today, I pray. Be with us, continue to be with us in the remainder of this service, and we'll give you the praise and the glory and the honor. Amen. Kenny, if you'll come up, we'll do communion this morning. Now, we did the same thing we did last week. We bent the tabs down so it's a little easier to pull. But hold the elements until we all take it together. And the Apostle Paul says in 1 Corinthians, that man needs to examine himself before he takes the elements. Let's pray. Our God, our Father, as we gather today at your table, we ask that you would, we ask you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit to bless and sanctify these elements to the souls of those who are partaking of them, that we may eat and drink in remembrance of the body and the blood of Christ as a witness to you, Lord, our eternal Father, that you are willing to take upon them the name of thy Son and remember to keep the commandments that you've given us. And we ask these things in your precious name. Amen. Amen. I wanted to give you another little story. I'm full of stories, aren't I? It's written by a man called Eric Mateus. Over 50 years ago, on July 20th, 1969, two human beings changed history by walking on the surface of the moon. But what happened before Edwin Buzz Aldrin and Neil Armstrong exited the Apollo 11 lunar module is perhaps even more amazing, if only because so few people know about it. The guy writes, I'm talking about the fact that Buzz Aldrin took communion on the surface of the moon some months after his return. He wrote about it in the Guidepost magazine. The background of the story is that Aldrin was an elder at his Presbyterian church in Texas during this period of his life, and knowing that he would soon be doing something unprecedented in human history, he felt he should mark the occasion somehow and ask his minister to help him with this. And so the minister consecrated a communion wafer and a small vial of communion wine And Buzz Aldrin took them with him out of the Earth's orbit and onto the surface of the moon. He and Armstrong had only been on the surface a few minutes when Aldrin made the following public statement. "This is the lunar module pilot. I'd like to take this opportunity to ask every person listening in, whoever and wherever they may be, to pause for a moment and contemplate the events of the past few hours and give thanks in his or her own way." He then ended the radio communication, and there, on the silent surface of the moon, 250,000 miles from home, he read the verse from the Gospel of John, and he took communion. Here is what his account of what happened. "In the radio blackout, I opened the little plastic packages that contained the bread and the wine. I poured the wine into a chalice our church had given me. In the 1/6 gravity of the moon, the wine slowly curled and gracefully came out, came to the side of the cup. Then he read the scripture, 'I am the vine and you are the branches. Whoever abides in me will bring forth much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing.'" He says, "I intended to read my communion passage back to Earth, but at the last minute, they have requested that I not do this. You see, NASA was already embroiled in a legal battle with Madeleine O'Hara and the celebrated opponent of religion over the Apollo 8 crew reading from Genesis when orbiting the moon at Christmas time. So I agreed reluctantly. I ate the tiny host and swallowed the wine. I gave thanks for the intelligence and the spirit that had brought two young pilots to the Sea of Tranquility. It was interesting for me to think the first liquid ever poured on the moon and the very first food eaten there were communion elements." Wow, isn't that amazing? "And of course, it's interesting to think that some of the first words spoken on the moon were words from Jesus Christ, who made the earth and the moon, and who, in the immortal words of himself, says, 'Love that moves sun and the stars.' Aldrin's brief and private Christian service never caused a flap, but it could have. Aldrin himself wrote of the communion in the Guidepost magazines in October of 1970, a year after the lunar landing." Isn't that amazing? Isn't God good? God saves us through the blood of his Son, Jesus Christ. In 1 Corinthians 11, 23, it says, "The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and then he had given thanks. When he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant of my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. So then, whoever eats the bread and drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. Everyone ought to examine themselves, therefore, before they eat the bread and drink from the cup. For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ eat and drink judgment upon themselves." Blood, or the bread represents the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, beaten and broken and pierced for us, that we may know the forgiveness of sin. Take, eat, and be thankful. The cup represents the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, spilled out for us to wash away our sins and provide for us the promise of eternal life. Drink this and be thankful. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, by your Spirit, you make us one in Christ, one with each other, and one in the ministry of Christ all over the world, until Christ comes in the final victory. Help us to be a witness to those around us today. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, let's sing The Family of God. This day and be with us and help us in everything we do, that we uplift you and glorify your name. Amen. Well, thank you, and go out and have a blessed day today.